So the fifth habit is seek first to understand, then to be understood. When I read this text as my group's topic, I remembered a philosophy lesson I had once. And the professor said, someone who likes philosophy shouldn't just judge, shouldn't criticize, should try to understand what's going on the other people's head. So it's a little bit about this we're going to talk now. First, to quote an example from the text the author uses. So he asks, if you go to an optometrist, an optometrist is the eye doctor, and the author asks, would you, if you go to this, if you have this appointment with an optometrist, and he or she says, hey, try these glasses on, I've been wearing them for 10 years and it's great, what do you say? No idea, okay, she got blind, you know, just like I am, with wearing, not wearing this. So this is an example from the text. You can't wear my glasses. And let me ask you, if I were this optometrist, would you go back to my office? No. Probably not. So this is the example from the author. The second example is, I'd like to ask you, please be sincere, did you love school in all its aspects? Were you happy, or are you happy now at college in all aspects?
Not at all.
So don't you have time? Isn't there any time which you are kind of disappointed and something bothers you anyhow? I love your emoticon face for me. Well, so there is another example about, it's about a conversation between a mother and a daughter, and she wants to have a conversation and her mother accepts to talk. Okay, what's it about? Mom, I'm not happy about school. I don't want to go anymore. And of course, the reaction is the same, I think. Tell me, please, what kind of reaction would you have, would your mothers have, would you think your mothers have, talking, you don't want to go to school anymore?
What do you think?
Absolutely. This is the intonation I imagine when I read the text. Something, no, this is absurd. You have to go because it's good for your future, not thinking about that. So this is the second example from the author. So he also says that very few people, yet about that optometrist example, very few people diagnose before prescribe. So he says that when you're having a conversation and someone comes to you talking about something, meaning a problem, this person tries to give you a reply. The instant reaction is not thinking about you and your problems, what you're going through, but giving you a reply, giving you a good advice. So I have said, the text begins with that quote, "The heart has its reasons which reason knows not of." I couldn't get it very well, but I believe that Pascal is a mathematician and a physicist from the 17th century. You know, all these things like Renaissance and Illuminism, all these theories coming off, and maybe he tried to say that, okay, I make science, but I can't explain, this science can explain all things, all problems, all issues. So this text also mentions about communication. People who study language, has been everybody here has attended a language course, even those who don't study letters, have an English course before and here. Well, so even you also, and I also, those who are not teachers but have studied language, somehow you have been having lessons of writing, reading, speaking, and listening. Those are the four basic skills of communication. But the author says, I believe the author is writing for, we're not thinking about this context of foreign language. He wrote for example, native speakers like Pauline, and I'd like to ask you, Pauline, have you ever had any specific lessons on listening English?
No.
Have you? No. So that's what the author says, that mainly, I believe you you say the same. I haven't had lessons on listening in Portuguese. No. We learn to write, we learn to read, we speak all the time, but we never learn to listen. So what? That's what the author says. And it's this is very important for us to try to understand something. We need to listen to what you have to say. And then about influence, he says, if you want to communicate effectively, because that's what this book is about, effective habits of effective people. So if you want to communicate effectively and if you want to influence me, you have to be yourself. You have to use your example, your actual conduct. So you have to be yourself to influence me. So he also mentions the private performance has to square with public performance. Okay, what does it mean? The author also mentions if don't go to someone and say you like someone if you don't, because it's not going to convince. It's not real. It's not your character. So if you try to use any technique, if you try to use any selling technique to convince me, the author says, I'm not going to it. So be sincere, make sincere. And also I believe that that book about from Dale Carnegie also says something like that. Make compliments, but they have to be sincere. Just don't fake it. It's written there, it's quoted, you have to build the emotional bank accounts. So he mentions this, what is this, emotional bank accounts? It's a metaphor for, so this emotional bank accounts is something like being trustworthy. So how much trust is put into a relationship is this emotional bank account. So he says you have to build emotional bank accounts to create commerce between hearts. That's what we're saying about, so being sincerely in treating in these relationships. And perfect listening. So it's that expression, being in someone's shoes, being in the other's shoes. Perfect listening means listen to understand and not only to reply. I have already said something about this, that we usually have to try to reply and not just listen, not to understand what we've been through. I know exactly how you feel. It's an excerpt from a conversation between a father and the author, and the father says, I don't know what to do, my son doesn't understand me, he doesn't listen to me. The author said, sorry, what do you mean? And he said again, my son doesn't understand me, he doesn't listen to me. And he asked one more time, what? And he got angry. My son does not understand me. He doesn't listen to me. Then he says, isn't it wrong? So for him not to understand, shouldn't you be listening to yourself? He can't understand because he didn't get the chance of listening to his child. So if you don't listen, you wouldn't get inside another person's frame of reference. So if that's because in this of being another person's frame of reference, so trying to think what you think, trying to understand what you think, your values, your opinion, this is the tip the author gives. He also compares sympathy and empathy. Sympathy and empathy are not the same. I thought those were, but it's not. I was looking at Michael's dictionary, and sympathy would be also something like judging. Judging are also compassion, and empathy not. Empathy is thinking. Emotional bank account, I have already said before. And this psychological error, the author also says, we all have survival necessity, survival needs. So the author even asks, if we take off all the air from this room, would you keep reading the book? Would you keep listening to me if all the air was taken off from the room? Please say you wouldn't. Please say no.
No.
Thank you. So that's it. You wouldn't just stay here if you took off all the air or even other threatening things. You would, of course, try to leave the room, just like I'm doing, and try to save your lives. And then we don't need only survival skills. Survival needs. We need this psychology here, because everybody needs to be trusted.
A doctor is a doctor 24/7. It's 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. And this subchapter, Diagnose Before You Prescribe, talks about you have to understand the problems of the person before you give her a tip or an advice, a piece of advice. It's like the author tells a story of a mother who has a 2-month-old kid, and the kid is sick, and it's a Saturday, and all the city is in a football game, and she calls the doctor, and the doctor is in the football game, and she says like, oh, my kid's sick, and she's vomiting, and I need something to her. The doctor prescribed her medicine, and she hang up the phone, and then she starts thinking, like, wait, I didn't tell my kid is only 2 months old. Does that matter? And her husband says, no, just buy the medicine and that's okay, give it to the kid. But she calls again and asks if it's a matter. And he says, oh, of course, he can take. The kid can take the medicine if it has only 2 months old. So if he asked before she tell her, she wouldn't have to call again and maybe risk the kid's life. This is a technique used in sales, like when you're selling something, you have to be aware of the needs of the buyer. You have to know what he wants and be sincere if you don't have it. In law, you have to think about what the other team is gonna do, what the other team is thinking, so you can go against it. And in product design, you have to, it's like you're going to design a chair. You have to think the needs of who is going to use the chair, so you can adapt the product to this kind of person. For autobiographical responses, it's like you have, when you listen to someone, you start thinking about what the person is saying based on your own experiences. That's why it's autobiographical. When you listen to someone, you first evaluate to see if you agree or disagree with her frame of view. Then you probe, you start asking her, like, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? You would be better that way. You advise, but you advise from what you should do, what you will do if you are her. Like, I don't want to go to school anymore. What do I have to do to want to go to school? But the other person is different of you. You have to think about why he or she doesn't want to go to school. And interpret, you start interpreting what she's saying or he's saying based on your frame of view. And that's 4 things you have to avoid to do while you're conversing. The author gives the example of a kid, like I say, that got to the father and says, Dad, I've had it, school is for the birds. It's like, I don't want to go to school anymore. My friend quit school and he's making money. He's a mechanic and I want to make money. He's making money and he's not going to school. Why do we go to school if we can make money without it? And then his father starts saying, you have to go to school. Well, we made sacrifice so you can go there. It's a good school. When I was in your place, I didn't see the point of it also. But you'll see when you come, when you're my age. And the son is thinking like, oh, my father is gonna talk about how he had to walk 2 miles to go to school on snow without boots, and he doesn't pay attention to what his father say. So here we have what the father should do. You start mimic content, you just repeat what the kid is saying, what the other person is saying. It's like your son gets to you and he says, I don't want to go to school anymore. You say, okay, you don't want to go to school anymore. And then the kid will start opening up to you. Then you reframe the content. You don't want to go to school anymore. You put in your own words what the other person is saying. Then you reflect feeling. You're feeling really frustrated. That's why you don't want to go to school. You get to the reason, and you reframe the content and reflect feeling. You put all the other ones together in only one, and you get to the point. You're really frustrated about school. And it takes time, but it can solve. In the end of the world, it's better this way, because it's like he gives the window example. If there's a lot of papers unpaged above the table, and the window is open, and it goes like, I have to put it all in order again, or I can close the window so it won't keep flowing.
So, that's the understanding, perception is the other part of the book. It's important to start this part is how you see the world. I use an example that you walk in the campus with a friend. For everything, you use the away to see something. You walk in the campus with your friend and pass a girl or a boy. Your friend say for you, oh, that's a beautiful girl, oh, that's a beautiful boy. And you say, oh my God, it's not beautiful, that's terrible. This happened for one reason. You use, some people use the left and right, the left side of the brain, and the other use the right side of the brain. And he used that example. Sometimes you look for someone and you think, oh, that's a young boy, or a old man, but he is the same age. Okay, it's a point of view. You have the two sides for everything. Everything that you look, you can see for the two sides, both sides. You must understand the other to negotiate, to do for anything in your life. If I talk with you, I came with him and say, how you will make a group? He's different than me, I imagine. And now, how I can negotiate with him if I don't understand his mind? He used that example, the negotiation. It's a president of a company goes to the other to talk about the financial group. Okay, but everybody's scared because the financial group will increase the tax, increase the cost of the work, and then the company say, oh my God, we need to make the contract. How do you do that? With the increase, we won't pay this. Okay, the president of the company had an idea, say, financial group, please, you write the contract. They wrote the contract. And everyone talking, oh my God, why you do this? Why you did this? And the president of the company said, no, now I can analyze. That's I can understand the problem. I can understand what they want. And this is the way that he made the contract. Because they talked with the other company, understand what they want. That's very important. You understand the other to enter a negotiation or do something. That's the point. So, he sits there, before you negotiate with someone, you must understand you, understand the situation, and understand and talk about what you want. He used the Greeks ancient philosophy with ethos, it's your character. If I negotiate with someone or talk with someone, if I want to do something with anyone here, what I do, what I want. First, how you see me? I'm a character, of course. Yeah, it's impossible, no. You're a character. You understand me, you see me, or anyway. Pets is the relation that we have. That relation I create to negotiate. And the logos, it's idea. Idea that I want to show for you. I want to say for you. This is the point. But so many people go to the other way. take the goals directly to others. Don't start to negotiate showing the pathos, showing the ethos, just go logos. Just wanna sell the idea. I wanna say, oh, okay, Paulinho, I wanna do this, this, this. Why she will help me? She doesn't understand me. She doesn't understand me. Why? She don't know who I am. How can I start talk? Do you remember the influence concerns and the influence, and the influence, influence concerns? The circle of influence and the circle of influence of concerns. That's the point. The habit 5 is the most important for this. Because if you talk about this, you always start of your influence circle, start listening the other, understand the other person. If you do this, the concerns being small, and when you be listening the other, create a connection, a heart connection, like he said in the test, you can do anything. Because just, oh, it's not Raphael talking with you. It's more than this. It's, we are in empathy. We are doing something together. We are having a connection. This is the point. This is the talk about the habit 5. You must create a connection between the people. Thank you guys. That's this. Thank you.